Blackstone Publishing and Skyboat Media present The Gospel According to Lazarus by Richard Zimler. This book is read by Stefan Rudnicki. In death, we never much resemble who we were in life, for all the mystery is gone. Lazarus ben Natan. A fair warning. Anyone who steals this scroll or sells it, disfigures it, or burns it, will suffer under the ban that Yehoshua, son of Nun, imposed on Jericho, and he shall be cursed with the 98 admonitions, and even his shadow will be erased, so that he will be forgotten by one and all, even his mother and father and children, and no devil, demon, spirit, or shade will be able to rescue him, and no amulet, talisman, conjuration, or counterspell will be of any use to him, and it will be as if he had never existed. In the name of Ariel, who guards the spheres of the sun, and Mikael, who protects each phase of the moon, I hereby declare that this ban and these admonitions can never be lifted, eased, or diminished. You will become a horror to all the kingdoms on earth. A history made of ifs. Such is the life of mortal men. Lazarus ben Natan. 1. Perhaps what Yeshua meant was simply that he wrote himself into my dream as a way of joining our paths together. After all, he was burdened at too vulnerable an age by all that he dared not reveal about his inner world. And he needed a companion who would listen to his confessions without judging him or betraying his secrets, and who would be willing to wade with him into the murkiest and most treacherous waters of Torah. Given his knowledge of all that remains hidden to the rest of us, however, he may have been implying that he created my dream and placed it in the sleeping mind of the 8-year-old I'd been. I suppose it is even possible that he wanted me to believe that he had traveled back in time, across a span of 28 years, and planted it inside me so that it would seem as if I, as a young boy, had been able to prophesy the most traumatic events of my adulthood. If I were to believe that he could foresee the entire scope and shape, not just of his life but of mine as well, then I would also have to accept the disquieting notion that he had known for some time where our journey would end. He had been aware that I would be forced to flee my blood-drenched home with my children, pursued by both Pharaoh and Zadok, holding his final gift to me inside my trembling embrace. Where you die, I too shall die, and there shall I be buried. Such was the pledge that Ruth the Moabite gave to her mother-in-law Naomi, and though the young woman's fidelity always moved me, it was only when I whispered her words to myself on a barren hillside, while gazing past Yeshua's crossbeam towards all that would never now come to pass, that I realized that she may very well have regarded it as an act of kindness for the Lord to end her life. I would not wish to believe he embroidered me skillfully and over the course of decades into the intricate weave of his plans, only to pull out every last thread and stand naked and broken before his executioners, and not just because of the decades of hope that I had placed in him. In truth, I resist that possibility because I have discovered that it is no comfort at all to know that there are men who can accomplish what seems impossible to the rest of us, feats that defy all our attempts at understanding. Beware of men who see no mystery when they look at their reflection. It was my father who told me that. He was speaking of a tyrannical Roman prefect at the time, but he believed that all of us are changed for the better, become more humble at the very least, when we recognize that our identity tends to slide away from us every time we strive to catch it. And if the I who directs our actions is not fixed and permanent, then how can we ever be certain of who we are and what God has asked us to do? If only I had glimpsed the possibility that the Romans would arrest him, then I'd have pressured him to flee with me to our homeland and refused to take no for an answer. But in the end, dearest grandson, there was no time left for pleas or arguments, which is yet one more indication that we are never truly at home in this world, though perhaps the Lord, too, wishes that he had more time on occasion. Would it be a heresy to suppose he might? If so, then I no longer care. 3 decades of longing and regret have earned me the right to speak to you honestly. Dear Yafiel, in order to begin writing this scroll that you now have in your hands, I purchased ink this morning from a stall at your favorite marketplace, the one favored by our island's flower sellers that comes to life each dawn beside the Temple of Athena. On reaching home, I locked myself away in my hidden prayer room. Can you see me there? At this very moment, I am seated on my mosaic of Yeshua, underneath the terebinth tree that grows at the center of my world. Picture the tip of my calamus as it designs these words. Picture me endeavoring to tell you of matters that will...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.